The dugu is a traditional weapon used by the Zulus. Many years ago, it was replaced by the axe in the Indian families. Indian families used to keep the axe behind the door, and they replaced it with the dugu. And when you think of village life, I come from village life 30, 40 years ago. Let me give you an example. If you went to your dad 40 years ago in the village I came from and you said to your dad, "Dad, I think it's a woman in me that wants to come out," your dad would gently reach for the dugu and he would strategically deliver a blow to your temporal lobe, which is the location of the memory center. I don't know how your dad knew that, but you would fall unconscious, and when you get up, and it'll usually be like the next day, when you get up in the morning, your dad will ask you, "Son, tell me about the woman." And you will say, "What woman?" But if you continue to talk about the woman, then you would get a second blow to the medulla oblongata. That's the back. And you'll feel giddy for a couple of days. And that's what we call being dugified. But I want to continue with the cherubim. And I just want to cut down on some of the jokes so we have enough time to finish the cherubim. As I mentioned, the cherubim is a feature of the tabernacle of David. And when we talk about the restoration of the tabernacle of David, we cannot only talk about the manna, the Aaron's rod that budded, the tablets of the law, the shittim wood, the gold and the rings and the crown. We also have to talk about the cherubim, which was a very important part of the Ark of the Covenant, the entire complex, very important part of the tabernacle of David. And the cherubim, as I mentioned to you yesterday, is a symbol picture of the perfect man, particularly the perfect man the man in his evolution, in his journey to perfection. And we trace the cherubim from the Garden of Eden to the tabernacle of Moses, Temple of Solomon, Ezekiel, and then the book of Revelation. And I just want you to see something in regards to that particular journey with the cherubim in the tabernacle of Moses. Let me read that to you in Exodus chapter 25, verse 17, because how does the journey take place? How does the journey take place to the perfect man? And Exodus 25, verse 17 reads, "You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2.5 cubits shall it be in length, and 1.5 cubits in width. And you shall make 2 cherubim of gold of beaten work. You shall make them at the 2 ends of the mercy seat. Make 1 cherub at 1 end and the other cherub at the other end. You shall make the cherubim at the 2 ends of it of 1 piece with the mercy seat." It's very interesting to see the construct of the cherubim. The cherubim was made of 1 piece of gold, and it had to be placed in the fire and beaten in the fire. And this is the journey to perfection, as Dr. Sam mentioned. The journey to perfection is punctuated with many perils and sufferings. And these sufferings come from God. Not only will you be placed in the fire, while you are in the fire, you will be beaten. That means this journey, there's a series of sufferings. Sometimes you have 7 or 8 bad news in one day. As a leader, particularly in your journey as a city leader, and this journey of of coming to city leadership, to coming to maturity, to coming to apostolic leadership. You cannot avoid this. In fact, Amos says, that the talks about a man who escapes from a bear, then he's so relieved that he had escaped from the bear, just when he's sighing in relief, he's attacked by a lion. And then as he escapes from the lion and gets into a house, he places his hand on the wall and is bitten by a snake. So there are a series of trials and tribulations that come to test the genuineness of your faith, come to reveal the attributes of God. Job came to realize that God is a compassionate and merciful God through the sufferings that he went. The Bible says, before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. Sufferings testify of our sonship. Sufferings make us dependent on God. Sufferings make us grow. And sufferings, in a way, they bring glory to God when God effects a gracious deliverance from our perils. So this journey to perfection has many sufferings. And I would not talk much about that. I'll leave Dr. Sam to deal with that. I want to go on to talking about the cherubim, particularly in its evolution. It moves from silence to vocalization, from inanimate to animate, from no eyes to eyes all over, from individual to corporate, from two wings to six wings. And the reason you see the ultimate cherubim having six wings, it has greater power to resist the gravitational pull of the earth. As you move to perfection, the world has no hold over you. You are able to fly. While others walk, you are able to fly. So this journey of perfection to perfection is epitomized in the journey of the symbol, the journey of the cherubim. And the cherubim is a picture of perfect leadership, of apostolic leadership. And you'll notice that in terms of leaders, the ultimate in leadership is a leader desires his followers to be like him. You'll notice that Jesus, the only time he rejoiced is when the 70 came to him and said, Lord, we are doing the same thing you are doing. And the Bible says in that hour, Jesus rejoiced. Today in many churches, if you tell the pastor you are doing the same thing as the pastor is doing, you're going to get yourself into all kinds of trouble. We find that Elisha also comes to the place where he does the same thing that Elijah is doing. Even in the model of Paul and Timothy, you find the same thing. So basically, leadership determines where the people will go. And when you study the cherubims, you begin to see all of this very, very clearly. So I want to turn your attention to Ezekiel chapter 1, and we're going to go through it line by line. And I think it's very important also in this conference to do some line by line teaching, because I, coming from a medical background, I know how important it is to be precise. Because a lot of folk out there get very confused. Coming from a medical background, I know that. Because sometimes if you tell patients, take the green tablet 3 times a day and the blue tablet 2 times a day, that's not being very specific, because sometimes there are 2 blue tablets. And sleeping tablets are often blue, but also Viagra tablet is blue. So if you are not specific and you're not giving patients the names of the tablets, you're not writing it down clearly, instead of the sleeping tablet, they take the Viagra tablet. And they stay happy the whole night. So we're going to look at Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1, and it reads, now it came to pass in the 30th year, in the 4th month, on the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives of the river Sheba, that the heavens were open and I saw visions of God. Now, the whole of chapter 1 in Ezekiel deals with the cherubim. And we have clues from the very beginning in the mention of the 30th year. 30 in the Bible, in Bible numerology, is the number of maturity. You know that Jesus was 30 years old when he came to Jordan and heavens opened. John the Baptist was 30 years old as a priest when he began his ministry. Joseph was 30 years old when he came before Pharaoh. David was 30 years old when he came to the throne. And here we see Ezekiel, 30 years old, and 30 is the number of maturity. 30 is the biblical number of sonship. And when we talk about sonship, we are talking about maturity. The battle today is not only the battle for sight, it's a battle for maturity. The tensions we have in the church today is because of the battle between the mature and the immature. And so in this battle for maturity, there's demands for maturity, the characteristics of maturity, especially within the ambit of sonship. A mature son is sober. The Bible says, you are sons of the day and not of the night. Therefore, walk and be sober. Sons are overcomers. They know how to face tribulation. They know how to come over them. Sons have the nature of the Heavenly Father. The Bible says, those he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Sons are directed by the Spirit of God. Sons are aware that they are custodians of an inheritance. Sons know that they walk in intimacy with God. And sons know that the demands of God is that they must come to perfection, in that they must walk with excellence, they must walk with restraint, they must walk with perception, they must walk with fruitfulness, be established in the Lord. Sons know that they must be crucified, they must be autonomous, and sons know that they must migrate beyond milk to strong meat. So within the context of Ezekiel chapter 1, when you read 30, whenever you read the word 30, the number 30, it's a reference to maturity. Then there's a second word, second number that comes out, and it says, it came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month. The number four also is very important in terms within the reference to the cherubim. The number four is the number of the apostolic. As I'm talking about this, I hope some of you are familiar with Bible numerology and you're not thinking of the ancient practice of Fafi. This is nothing to do with Fafi. This is Bible numerology, and this is a valid system of interpretation. So four is the number of the apostolic. And I say it's the number of the apostolic because teleologically, it is reference to the fourth measure, of Ezekiel. You notice that there were four levels. There was the first measure of 1,000 cubits, then another 1,000 cubits, and the fourth measure was waters to swim in. And when Ezekiel came to that dimension at the fourth measure, that's when he could no longer walk through the waters. The waters began to control him. The waters began to lead him. And it was at this final level that he sees the fruit trees. So within the apostolic, the teleological principle being the principle in reference to the purpose, end, goal, and function of a thing. And we find that the number four is closely associated numerically with the apostolic in terms of its teleology. Secondly, the number four historically also refers to the apostolic, because 12 is a multiple of four, and you know that there were 12 apostles of the Lamb, and so when we refer to the four, we are also referring to the 12. And apostolically and historically, it refers to the 12. It refers to the operating system of the 12. It refers to the nature of the 12, the substance of the 12, the authenticity of the 12. So when we read the number 4, it references to the operating system of the first century apostles. Thirdly, etymologically, it also refers to the number 4. The apostolic is connected to the number 4. The word apostolic derived from apostle, which is sent one, to apostello, that's where it's derived from, sent one, and the one we sent is sent to 4 locations, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the world. When you study the brazen altar of the tabernacle of Moses, it had 4 horns that pointed in 4 different directions, pointing to the sent dimension in 4 different directions. So when you look at the Greek word apostello, which is translated as sent, it means to be sent by, it also means to be sent of, it means to be sent in, and it means to be sent through. And that's a 4-dimensional meaning of apostello. To be sent by is just a physical sending. To be sent of means the one that is sent as the same substance as the one that sent him. Therefore, apostles are called holy because they carry the holiness of God, the same substance of God. And to be sent in, that means they represent the one that sent them. And to be sent through means that they represent and carry the authority of the one that sent them. And this is in clear distinction to another word that is translated as sent. The word is pempo, which means just a physical sending. For instance, when the prodigal son became poor, he was sent, the Bible says, by a citizen of the country to the pigsty. So just being sent does not mean you're an apostle. The word sent could be a pempo sending. That means someone just sent you. It was a physical sending, and it is not an apostello sending. And the word for etymologically is connected to the apostolic. And the sending is of such a nature that if you know him, you know the Father, you receive him, you receive the Father, you imitate him, you imitate the Father, you hear him, you hear the Father. And so those are the dimensions of the apostolic connected to the number 4. This is a big word, epistemologically, it deals with the knowing. How does the apostolic church know what it is preaching? It's very simple. It is governed by the voice of God. And you see the number 4 featuring again when it comes to knowing the voice of God, because if you look at Samuel and Eli, it was the 4th time that Eli came to understand the voice of God. Ontologically, you find the number of 4 featuring again. Ontology is the study of being. Unfortunately, there are no synonyms for these words. I tried to find easier words, but there's no synonyms for these. And also, this is a conference. I like to use big words from time to time. So, ontologically, which is a study of being, and you notice that there are 4 living creatures in the midst of and around the throne. In the midst of and around the throne. Epitomizing the principle of in him we live and move and have our being. Logically, the number 4 also features again where we find the 4 lepers logically walked out. Why sit we here and die? So within an apostolic paradigm, there is the application of logic. And this is very important to understand, that reason is not incompatible with faith. It was Thomas Aquinas who first wrote that document about reason and faith. He said that those are not incompatible. In fact, they are collaborative. They can work together. And while people thought that faith and revelation came from God in that generation, they believed reason came from the devil. But Thomas Aquinas said both those things come from God. And he said that faith could be guided by reason and reason could be used to demystify faith. So there is great logic within the apostolic paradigm. Culturally, you find the number four featuring again within an apostolic paradigm. Acts 2:42 unveils the four pillars of an apostolic culture: apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread, prayer. And these cannot be divorced from the definition of the apostolic. Christocentrically, you find the number four featuring again within the apostolic, where Jesus, the chief apostle, is given a color scheme in the tabernacle of Moses of purple, scarlet, white, and blue. And also the fact that the four beasts also point to Christ, the lion, ox, man, and eagle. And if you study the book of John, the four Passovers that Jesus went through. Sociologically, the number four also points to the apostolic, because the apostolic embraces the corporate rather than the singular. And as we get into the cherubims, we will find that the cherubims did not operate alone. The wings touched each other. The next number that is very important, also in terms of the corporate, you know that there were four positions in carrying the ark. And also you know that there were four camps of people around the Ark of the Covenant. They were arranged rather in four camps. The tribes were arranged in four camps. And also you see four men bringing the lame man through the roof. Now, let me read this to you again. Ezekiel chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. Now, I've used these words to explain how important the number four is. I remember a young girl coming to me and asking me, "Pastor, what is the apostolic perspective on having tattoos?" And I said to her, "Well, teleologically, it is inconsistent with your destiny, because a tattoo is a symbol of independence and our destiny is a corporate." I said, "Historically, it's an invasion, it's a pagan culture invading the church. Existentially, it is compatible, but the existentialist chooses his own ways and his own laws." I said, ontologically, makes you a common thing because you are fighting for your identity. And I said, logically, it is self-mutilation. I said, objectively, it is an addition because something is missing in your life and you need a prosthesis, and therefore you have a tattoo. I said, genetically, it reveals that you are bound by lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. Ideologically, it reflects what's in your mind. Culturally, you are consistent with a postmodern ethos. And analytically, I want to say to you, it's attention seeking. And literally, it is a religion. And I said, symbolically, it's a false sense of immortality. And she said, "Wow." A few weeks later, I saw her and she had the tattoo. And she said to me, "Pastor, thank you for your advice." I think we're not reaching the people. But now I know, because I'm talking to pastors, I'm using these terms. The Bible says in Ezekiel 1, "Came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day of the month." And it's very important to realize all these numbers connected to the apostolic. The number five is the number of grace, because there's a reason for that. The fifth time Noah's name is mentioned, it is connected to grace. The fifth time Ruth is mentioned, grace is mentioned. Five offerings of grace that was transacted between Jacob and Esau for appeasement. The fivefold gifts are grace gifts. We don't have the time to go to how the number five operates in that context. The fifth kingdom was initiated by a stone that became a mountain that expresses its rule in grace and glory. The incense oil at 5 components, anointing oil at 5 components, the covenant of Abraham at 5 offerings, and Abraham, when his name was converted to Abraham, it was through the 5th insertion. Abram, A-B-R-A-M, the addition of H was a 5th letter, and even in the Hebrew, the letter H, which is He, is the 5th letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So you find that these numbers are loaded in terms of explaining the cherubim, that they operate from the context of maturity of the corporate son, they operate with an apostolic paradigm, and they operate with grace. And when I say apostolic paradigm, that means the whole church is supposed to be apostolic because Jesus is the chief apostle. The Bible says, as he is, so are we. If he is the chief apostle and he is apostolic, we must all be apostolic. That means pastors must be apostolic, evangelists must be apostolic, the local church must be apostolic. And we see that in the context of the cherubims. In Ezekiel 1:3 it says, the word of the Lord came expressly to Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Sheba, and the hand of the Lord was upon him there. And the word here, the Hebrew word for word is the word dabar. It means the spoken word. And for us today, what has been very significant in the apostolic season from our journey in 1994 in Durban was the importance of the preceding word. That there is a preceding word and a proceeding word. And the proceeding word is a manna word, yesterday's manna, today's worms. The proceeding word is a new word. The proceeding word is an anointed word. It's what the Spirit is saying to the churches. And the Spirit has been saying a lot of things to us in the last decade, has been talking to us in our own journey about the principles of autonomy, the principles of the set man, the principles of the second man, the principles of dominion as opposed to the doctrine of disappearance, the principles of rest, the principle of the Father-Son wineskin, intimacy with God, and now the body of Christ. And the proceeding word, when it came to us, really unraveled us. For when we were building church, we were building it on the basis of pastor and members. And I still remember freshly when the Lord spoke to me, and the way the Lord would speak to me would be through his word. The Lord hardly speaks to me through dreams and visions. Neither have I had any significant angelic encounters. In fact, the only angel I met, I married. I haven't met any other angels after that. It's very important to know that as the word is proceeding, when this doctrine of the Father and Son came to us, God showed us how he's restoring the tabernacle of David, and he referred me to Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth was the son of Jonathan, and when Jonathan's nurse came to hear that Saul and Jonathan had died, she grabbed hold of Mephibosheth and fled. Notice she fled because of what she heard. And the Bible tells us she dropped. Mephibosheth was 5 years old. And for us, symbolically and metaphorically, as the Lord was speaking to me, the Lord was saying to me that the nurse represents institutional Christianity. And institutional Christianity cannot carry the number 5. Institutions cannot carry grace. Institutions cannot dispense grace. You need a spiritual father to dispense grace. And so yes, Mephibosheth, he was dropped, he damaged both his feet, he was lame, and he was growing up in Lodabar. Lodabar means a dry place, and many folk who have been dropped by institutions find themselves in the dry place. And where did Jesus send the demons to? He sent them to the dry place. That's a rendezvous with demons. And so when when David was ratifying his covenant, sitting on his throne, thinking about who he owes favors to. He thought about his covenantal relationship with Jonathan, and he wanted to know if any were remaining of the household of Jonathan. And one of his servants told him, there's someone by the name of Mephibosheth, and he's staying in Lodabar. And David sent his chariots to fetch Mephibosheth. He was lame. And when Mephibosheth came before David, he fell at David's feet and said to David, I am a dead dog. And David said to him, I will not accept you as a dead dog. I will not accept you as a servant. From today onwards, you will be my son. You will sit at my table and you will eat my food continually. And that became a rhema to us of the proceeding word of God in the restoration of the tabernacle of David, of how we should build an household of faith, that there is a David and members have to leave the place of Lodabar, have to leave the place where they have been wounded by institutions and come and sit at David's table. When you come and sit at David's table, you do not get healed of your lameness. Your defect stays, but David's table will cover your defect. David's table will cover your defect. I say to pastors, if you are bound by pornography, if you are bound by sexual addiction, there's a table which you can sit at, which can cover your defect, which can protect you, which can deliver you from your hormonal imbalance. And there is an anointing flowing through the table. There's an anointing flowing through the father-son wineskin to protect you. Listen, when you got saved, your flesh was not eradicated. Every pastor, every believer has a fundamental flaw in that the flesh is still around. There's a wrong doctrine that teaches that when you got saved, that your flesh was eradicated. Therefore, you need protection. And your protection is a father, your protection is a table, your protection is a company of believers who can identify your blind spot and cover you and help you in this journey. You're not going to make it alone. I just lament the independent pastor who chooses to stay in Lodabar. He will not survive this season. This is a new season. As we're going to study this, we're going to find out more about these cherubims and how they emerge and how they operate on the earth. So the proceeding word is a manna word. It's an anointed word. It is a now word. It is a new word, sometimes a new interpretation to a particular portion of scripture. For instance, Luke chapter 15, which most of you are familiar with, the prodigal son. You can deal with that soteriologically and talk about it in the context of salvation. But there's different perspectives that God can give us of that particular story. For instance, when the Lord was talking to us about that story, and the Lord used to talk to us in symbols. He used to tell us that story is not just about the prodigal son. In your context, that story is about a prodigal mother. You come from an Indian background. You know that a house is empty without a mother. And the whole problem in that story is the mother is absent. And when the mother is absent, the sons become delinquent. And symbolically, the mother is a prophet and the father is the apostle. So if you're just building with the apostle and you don't have partnerships with prophets, the end result is delinquent sons in the house. Proceeding word. Then we find out, word of the Lord came expressly to Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the river Sheba. And the hand of the Lord was upon him there. God does not have a hand. When the Bible says hand of the Lord, metaphorically, it speaks of the fivefold ministry. And the fivefold ministry very often is not present within the context of a local church. Fivefold ministry is present within the context of a city church with the body of Christ in the city. So when you walk into a city church, and in many cities there's no city church, and so these cities suffer because there's no restraining influence on evil. The city church is a Samuel of the city. And as that city church begins to gather, the hand of the Lord acts against the Philistines all the days of Samuel. One man conferred a protective mantle on a whole nation. And today that one man is not a singular man, it is a corporate man. And when that corporate man begins to rise up in every city, we're going to see a restraining influence on evil. We're going to see a restraining influence on crime and violence and hijackings. The Lord will heal the land. But it's because pastors refuse to recognize the corporate reality and are still living in a post-modern culture of individualism. We find in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1, it came to pass in the 30th month, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river Sheba, that the heavens were open. The heavens were open. The cherubims are associated with an open heaven. This kind of leadership. When we come to this stature, the heavens will open. And that's just as Jesus left Galilee, and Galilee means a circle. Jesus left Galilee, came submitted to a man, bowed down to a man. The Bible says after that, the heavens opened. There is another journey, and it's the journey of the corporate. As he is, so are we on the earth. The corporate man has to leave the circle of discontent, has to leave the circle of wanderings in the wilderness, and shift to this location. And when the corporate man comes to Jordan, comes to the place of descent, comes to the place of humility, corporate humility, we'll see the heavens open over every city. We will see what happened with the same thing that happened with Jesus, the localization of the Spirit of God, the clarity of the voice of God. And the Bible says, Jesus said, it is written, I think about 3 or 4 times, you're going to find the proceeding word begin to flow through the city. You're going to see the departure of every oppressive element, as you see in Matthew chapter 3 and Matthew chapter 4. You're going to see the capacity to teach difficult things. And you're going to see signs, wonders, miracles, all of those things happen in the context of an open heaven. And in many cities today, the heavens are shut. So that when you bring a medical doctor like me to certify whether people were really healed in the service, you find that they were not really healed. It was nothing more than placebo effect. And that's because the heavens are shut. And God will no longer operate as he did in the charismatic era with individual celebrity leadership. God wants us to migrate to this new position of the corporate. And when the corporate is in operation, the hand of the Lord begins to operate within the context of the corporate. And you'll see an open heaven again. You will see unusual signs, wonders, miracles, healings, deliverance. And the Lord will do a quick work and finish it in righteousness. The Bible says, the heavens were open and I saw visions of God. This is divine revelation. Divine revelation is connected to the cherubim. Where there is no revelation, the people perish. This open heaven context brings open visions, brings revelation of God. The cherubim leadership is connected to revelation of God. Cherubim leaders are not false fathers. They are not false apostles. False apostleship is epitomized in Saul, people like Saul who wants to kill the emerging David. Laban, false picture, false apostle, wants to milk the emerging apostolic. Moab wants to kill the son. Pharaoh, kill the spirit of witness. Herod, kill the spirit of witness. Adoni-Bezek wants to cut off your toe and cut off your big toe and your thumb. He wants to divorce the apostolic from the church. And all these are false fathers. And Uzziah was such a one. The Bible says, in the year that Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Isaiah said, in the year that Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. That means while Uzziah was living, Isaiah did not see the Lord because Uzziah blocked the view. So many leaders today block the view of Christ. And when cherubim leadership emerges, ordinary men and women will receive revelation of visions from heaven, visions of God. In Ezekiel 1:4 it says, "Then I looked and behold, a whirlwind was coming out of the north, a great cloud with raging fire engulfing itself. Brightness was all around it, and radiating out of the midst like the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire." This is beyond the wind of Pentecost. This is a whirlwind. The cherubim is not associated with the wind of Pentecost. The cherubim is associated with a whirlwind. This is a ferocious wind. This is a wind of deconstruction. It is a wind that will uproot, disconnect, dislocate, and scatter. You could read Hebrews chapter 12, verse 26, where God promises to shake everything. And it is in the context of cherubim leadership. You're going to find global shakings. And the shakings are going to take place in the church as you see cherubim leadership beginning to emerge. You'll notice out of the wind of Pentecost, 120 disciples emerged. Out of the whirlwind, you get four living creatures. And these four living creatures, 120 of course, being a multiple of four. And we see crystallized four living creatures coming to perfection, convergence, concentration. And in Ezekiel 1:4 it says, "Behold, a whirlwind was coming out of the north, a great cloud with raging fire engulfing itself, and brightness was all around it, and radiating out of its midst like the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire." Notice what features in this whirlwind. There is a cloud and there is fire. And we are well acquainted with that. In the wilderness, there was a cloud covering the people. And there was a pillar directing the people. And the cloud is a picture of the apostle that brings covering. And the pillar of fire is the picture of the prophet giving direction. But when you come to this position of the whirlwind, when you come to the cherubim, you'll find that you cannot make the distinction between the cloud and the fire because they merge as one in the whirlwind. And this is what God's going to do when the whirlwind of cherubims begin to manifest on the earth. You are not going to worry about who's the apostle and the prophet, because they are going to say, "Look at us, not look at me." So you're no longer going to follow people on the basis of their giftings. You're no longer going to be enthralled by their giftings. You're going to see us. You're going to see the corporate reality of church beyond local church, because a whirlwind is going to become very disruptive. It's going to disconnect. It's going to scatter. And the Bible says the color of it was the color of amber. And amber is bronze. And any student of Bible symbols will tell you that bronze is the color of judgment. So the cherubim is associated with judgment. The cherubim comes as Zechariah would use other symbols. He would talk about the flying scroll in Zechariah chapter 5. The flying scroll had a length of 20 cubits and a breadth of 10 cubits. That means its area was 200 cubits, and to any student of symbols, an area of 200 cubits referred to the holy place. And the holy place is the candlestick on the left, the table of showbread, and the golden altar of incense. And the fulfillment of that is seen in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, apostles' doctrine, candlestick, table of showbread is fellowship and breaking of bread. Golden altar of incense is prayer. So when you hear about judgment the Bible says when this flying scroll moved, it brought judgment. It brought the color amber. It brought bronze. And it says it judged the thief and the perjurer. So within this whirlwind, within this fire and cloud together, there's going to be a visitation of judgment. And this judgment is going to be exercised against two kinds of people, against the thief and the perjurer. And you'll find the same thing happened seminally in the book of Acts, where the thief was judged. Ananias and Sapphira judged in the midst of revival, in the midst of reformation, where everyone was having a great time, where there was great joy in the city. The word of the Lord was growing mightily and prevailing. In the midst of that great joy, two people died because they were thieves. We find that Elymas the sorcerer and Simon the sorcerer, both of them perjurers, false witnesses, are judged in an apostolic culture. When you build apostolic culture in your church, you build an habitat that is so powerful, you don't have to have spies in the church. You don't have to have armor bearers. You don't have to have cup bearers. You don't even have to have pall bearers. You don't have to have any of those. When you come into an apostolic culture, there is judgment for the thief and the perjurer. That means Jezebel was a charismatic problem. It's not our problem anymore. Absalom was a charismatic problem. Korah was a charismatic problem. Adonijah, a charismatic problem. Pharisees and scribes and false brethren, charismatic problem. You come into an apostolic culture, we do nothing to you. We just bless you and we love you. But the flying scroll will judge you. The culture will deal with you. I don't have time to go through how many thieves and perjurers were judged in our city within the culture of an apostolic paradigm. This is a powerful matrix. And we, as apostolic people, must know how to cultivate the culture of apostolic doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread, and praise. And that is stamped out in Scripture cryptically in over 30 places. What do apostles and prophets do? They come to bring the culture of the kingdom. They come to install the kingdom, the culture of the kingdom, even in local churches. All we do is install the software and go away. I want you to know, in apostolic culture, we produce low maintenance churches, but churches that are high impact. Churches that touch nations, exert an influence beyond their numbers. That's why we talk beyond mega church. We talk about the mega son. How an apostolic culture produces mega sons. Sons that can influence nations. The Bible uses this word, says, even the feeble amongst you will be like David. That happens in the culture of the apostolic. Bible says in Ezekiel 1:5, therefore an apostolic house is an house of decrees. It's an house of decrees. An apostolic house is beyond Daniel and beyond Joseph. These are good models, but Daniel was a eunuch. Daniel was a slave. Joseph was also a slave. Joseph married the daughter of Pharaoh. He compromised. And although they are good people, good models, the apostolic model is Elijah. And Elijah comes with decrees. Elijah does not come to work with the system. Elijah comes to judge the system. Elijah comes to talk to municipal leaders. He doesn't come to ask permission. He comes to make decrees. Can you imagine some leaders went to him, 50 leaders? Elijah was minding his own business on the mountain, and they came to him and said, oh, servant of the Lord. And Elijah said, if I really am a servant of the Lord, let fire come from heaven and kill you guys. The apostolic season is a season of confrontation. It's a season of facing Jezebel and overcoming. Elijah was not suitable for the mantle. The mantle was transferred to Jehu, transferred to Elisha, and one other, Azael. So this apostolic season is a season of aggression. And the amazing thing is, God has used gentle people to be aggressive. This is the paradox. This is a paradox because by nature, I'm a coward. You can ask my wife if there's a snake in our yard. I use my authority to tell her to go outside and kill the snake. And thank God she's obedient and submissive. That's when I call my rank. But by nature, I'm a coward. I'm gentle. And we are called to be lambs. But this apostolic season will make the lion in you roar. And this apostolic season is intolerable to those who oppose what God is doing on the earth. And that's why there's so much of strife and contention and so many battles within cities. In our own cities, people took my books, they took my tapes in churches, and they burnt them. They destroyed them. People talk about persecution in Iran and Iraq. That's a different kind of persecution than the persecution you would experience in America. The American true church is a persecuted church at this moment. It's a different kind of persecution. There's economic boycotts. You're being lampooned and lambasted on television. And even we suffered all those abuses. We suffered boycotts. I remember in the first 4 years of our own ministry, every pastor in our city refused to come and preach in our church. We were the official pariahs in our city. But God has elevated us in stature because we stood for truth and righteousness. We stood for truth and righteousness. We stood for the word of God. We went against Bible colleges. When I stood up publicly and said in my city among all the pastors, there is no rapture. It is a cunningly devised fable. It has destroyed Africa. You must understand, in those days, no one was talking like that. And all hell broke loose in our city. When I said there's no mansion in heaven, you are the mansion. That means if there's a mansion in heaven, and after you die, you are a spirit. And if you're going to be living in a mansion, then that's going to be a haunted house. We spoke publicly about these issues. We said that you cannot take the precious blood of Jesus and apply it on inanimate objects like cars and houses. People thought that we had disrespect for the blood, but in fact, we spoke those things out of a great respect for the blood of Jesus. So this apostolic season is a season of aggression. It's a season of confrontation. And I want you to know that Elijah took the mantle and wrapped his face because the apostolic season is antagonistic to a celebrity culture. It is a faceless move. And that's why God is raising up sons, not one or two sons, sons who will contend at the gates. Bible tells us, as for from within it came the likeness of four living creatures, and this was the appearance, they had the likeness of a man. That means these four living creatures, these cherubims, were approachable. They could reason. The Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 1 verse 7, their legs were straight and the soles of their feet were like the soles of calves' feet. They sparkled like the color of burnished bronze. These cherubims are righteous. They have been to the street called straight. The soles of the feet were calves' feet, clean animals. This kind of leadership is passionate about righteousness. The speech is seasoned with salt. It carries grace. This kind of leadership does what is right in the sight of the Lord. They give not because they can get. They give because it is the right thing to do. They pray not because they can get something from God. They pray because it is the right thing to do. They worship and sing praises to God, not because they can have breakthrough, but because it is the right thing to do. They obey because it is the right thing to do. They endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the city because it is the right thing to do. They make sacrifices because it is the right thing to do. That means they are against the capitalistic invasion of the church where you do something spiritual because you can barter and bargain with God. This Leadership is a righteous leadership. It is a leadership given to good works. The Bible says Jesus went about teaching and doing good. And every church must engage in good works. We are the salt of the earth. The Bible says to do good and to give, to share. Do not forget, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. We know that faith pleases God, but when you do good works, the Bible says us, with such sacrifices, he is well pleased. In terms of righteousness, not only good works, it's self-control, it's equity, justice, obedience, uncompromising sincerity. All of these principles are epitomized in cherubim leadership. Their legs were straight. They sparkled like the color of burnished bronze. Again, a picture of judgment. Ezekiel 1:8, the hands of a man were under the wing on the four sides, and each of the four had faces and wings. Again, the hand is a symbol of fivefold ministry. And the fivefold ministry is realized with cherubim leadership in the context of the corporate culture. Cherubims must not only be seen as individual leadership. You'll see later on how it comes into the corporate. Notice in Ezekiel 1:9, the wings touched one another. The cherubim exemplifies the ethos of a corporate culture. There is no such thing as a singular cherubim. The wings are touching another cherubim. And this is so important in understanding city building. There's no person's going to do it his own. Okay, how anointed you are, how much of money you have, you're not going to do it alone. You need to be connected to others, other apostolic leaders. Notice these cherubims. The creatures did not turn when they went, but each one went straight forward. Cherubim leadership moves forward. They are not preoccupied with the past. They are clear with the issues of the danger of a past focus. The Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 10, as for the likeness of the faces, each had the face of a man, each of the four had the face of a lion on the right side, each of the four had the face of an ox, and on the left side, and each of the four at the face of an eagle. This leadership as a face of a man is reasonable, as a face of a lion is able to rule and govern, as the face of an ox it is able to serve, and as the face of an eagle, it has an heavenly perspective. Notice the Bible tells us in verse 11, the wings were stretched upward, two of each one touched one another, and two covered their bodies. So these cherubims had four wings. The wings were pointing upward towards heaven, and at the same time, two wings were touching the other cherubim's wings, and two wings were covering the body. So this is very powerful in symbolism. The fact that the wings are touching each other points to the globalization of leadership, the globalization of church leadership. You're able to move across and around. At the same time, you're able to cover, this kind of leadership is able to cover its body. It's about localization. It's about the ability to lead even small groups of people, the ability to lead local churches. And these wings are pointed in an heavenly direction, speaking to us about the ability to access revelation from the throne of God. In fact, when you look at the direction of the wings, it begins to speak to us about what apostolic leadership is all about. An apostolic leader must be able to go before the people. That means he must be precedent. First in time, order, rank, arrangement, significance. He must be able to go before the people. At the same time, an apostolic leader must be able to reach out into heaven and access revelation and be above the people. At the same time, the apostolic leader must be able to cover the local body. That means he must be in and among the people. These three things are very important. He must be precedent, he must be in front, he must be transcendent, he must be above, he must know how to reach out into heaven, and he must be imminent. That means he must know how to be in and amongst the people. If he is only precedent, then the end result of that is he will produce admirers in his church. He will become a celebrity. If he's only imminent, working amongst the people, he will produce familiarity. If he is only transcendent, only able to reach out into heaven, then the end result of that is he'll produce mysticism. The great problem we have today is that a large number of pastors are not imminent. They don't know how to live and walk amongst the people. And that kind of leadership is being disqualified with the emergence of a father-son wineskin. The Bible tells us, as for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire and like the appearance of torches. Fire was going back and forth among the living creatures. The fire was bright, and out of the fire went lightning, and the living creatures ran back and forth in appearance like a flash of lightning. Notice fire is mentioned four times. This is the apostolic prophetic dimension of being baptized in fire. And being baptized in fire, although in its initial interpretation speaks about the baptism of suffering, trials, and tribulations, which is always the case with true apostolic leadership, the baptism in fire also unveils another principle. The Bible tells us that Jeremiah was struggling with preaching the word. He says, I'm not going to preach this word. Every time I preach it, it gets me into trouble. And then he said, how can I stop speaking the word? The word is in my heart like fire in my bones. And this is the very nature of apostolic people. Baptized in the fire means that they cannot resist but point to sola scriptura. My time is up. I want to leave you with that. I know I told you, I didn't warn you. I have a tendency of stopping suddenly because these messages do not have an ending. In my next session, I will come and complete this session. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Dr. Segi. So you got much to think about, don't you? One of the things we said at the very inception of this leadership summit is that the day of the Lord is the day of provocation. And it is very easy for fathers of households or leaders of congregations or tribes to harden their hearts, as in the day of provocation, and deny themselves entry into the land of promise. And a lot of stuff that happens in provocation challenges the status quo of contemporary and historical thinking. And if we do not challenge the things that we've inherited, we would not be able to enter into the new, but only live in the caves of previous traditions. And while we do not attack our past, we are also entrusted with the responsibility of being custodians of the present, even though we choose to live in the prophetic destiny of the future, which is in God. And so it's very important that a lot of stuff that we have taken as a complete article in our lives go through processes of radical alteration. And one of it is the whole idea of how we lead churches. The fathering principle, now we're getting introduced to the principle of the cherub, which amplifies our understanding of fathering. So it's very, and of leadership, of governmental leadership in this present season. But there are other concepts, like, for example, Dr. Segi spoke about the controversies that have surrounded ministries like his, mine, and others. Controversies that have not been completely understood, But people rush to judge without at least listening to what is being said about our review of the interpretation of heaven, which to a large degree has been defined by the ideology of capitalism, which is a utopian ideology that seems to offer you a better life of what you could not get in this life, which is a house, a paved street, some jewels in the crown, and often sold a gospel of works so that you can get points to get a better place in heaven. And these things need to be very critically reviewed in the season that we're living in. The gospel, the mythology and error of the rapture doctrine that this world is not your own, governed by Gnosticism, which seems to suggest that God did not know what he was doing when he created the earth, because the earth is an evil place and that he's got a better place for us. And yet God said, in the beginning, he created the heavens and the earth. And they cannot work but together. They are interlinked. And so we choose to prejudice on the crafty and intelligent workings of God by voting to as to where we want to live. And so many of us would choose heaven and wish that the earth will be destroyed, whereas God says that he will give us a qualitatively or regenerated heaven and earth in which righteousness will dwell. And so when we get those views, then you can't hold on to this mythology that was birthed out of a dream that a young girl had about 100 years ago, not 2,000 years ago, that the church will disappear because the devil is too powerful and that we will not be able to triumph over him. That does not mean that we do not believe in the return of Jesus Christ. We believe the apostolic season that we represent in South Africa believes in the physical, literal, visible, bodily return of Jesus Christ. We will meet him. We will see him. We'll meet him in the air, but not that we're a weak, cowardly bunch of people that will disappear because Antichrist is too great for us. The Bible says, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. And the last enemy that will be conquered is death. Last, eschatos. There's nothing after last. But we believe and we're looking forward today to the day when we can produce a corporate man that can receive the first amongst us all back, and we'll be with him to rule with him over all things, both in heaven and on earth. You understanding? So don't go around telling people, oh, they don't even believe in the coming of Jesus. That's not what we're saying. We are saying we don't believe in this denial gospel of escapism, which seems to suggest that we're a weak bunch of people. The church God is raising is going to establish the knowledge of his glory over the entire earth, and there'll be no place for the devil in that economy. So please understand these things, and we've got stacks of teaching, stacks of it. We know that some of you are here for the first time. Go and study it, and don't go by what some great preacher said. Go by what the Bible says. It's called sola scriptura. It just highlighted that, the word only, the word only. So when you leave here today, go with a heart that wants to see whether everything that has been said can be verified, authenticated, certified, attested by the integrity of this word. Not the iPad, the word. Oh, by the way, somebody lost the iPad. You must get it if you forgot about it. All right, get it from the info. But go by the word of God. Can you say that? Say to your neighbor, sola scriptura. The word only. And the just shall live by faith. And faith comes by hearing. And hearing by? Faith does not come by reading, so you need people like Segi. Okay, that's it for today, but I want to do one thing before we leave. It's a prophetic impression that we must close the session with, and we need to pronounce a prayer which I'm going to ask John Alley to pray for us before we leave. And I've tested the prophecy, and I want to affirm it. It comes from Elijah Morgan, who is a member of our family and who is respected as a prophet in our circles, and one that I respect. And he's from Switzerland. The prophetic word received or spoke by John Alley on Wednesday night. And this is it. John is an untainted apostolic messenger with an untainted message. The prophetic word received on Thursday morning as John Alley spoke. For the ascended Christ speaks. Now this is the prophetic word. I sent you many apostolic messengers who brought you messages of grace, but you did not receive the grace because you tainted the messenger and the message. These messengers are here today, but you cannot receive grace because you have tainted them with the words of your mouth. In your spirits, these messengers are tainted. Now behold, the Lord is gracious and merciful. He has sent you John Alley as an untainted messenger with an untainted message. He's a man without guile. Now therefore, repent and cry out for forgiveness so that the tainted messengers become untainted in your spirits so that the Father may release all the grace that was intended for you, his favorable vessels. Let me put this in another way. This move of God started in this country at least 21 years ago. This move of God, I think, personally, maybe my default prejudicial thinking, is more advanced in this country than in most countries of the world. It's a prejudice, but I've traveled about 80 countries in the world, and that's the perspective I've come to. We have some of the most advanced exponents of this message, and we have received some of the greatest opposition to it in this country. Much of it was because in our early days of presenting this message, our zeal and passionate desire to communicate it robbed us of understanding that all messages have to be communicated with the innocence of a lamb and yet with the force and authority of a lion. And so we had allowed naivety, zeal that was perceived as arrogance, foolishness, a lack of wisdom, and a whole host of levels of immaturity in our presentation of the message. And as a result, this message, this season, has left a sour taste in the mouths of many people. And some have not yet come to a place of realizing that God is speaking. And they got so caught up with looking at the vehicle that was carrying God that they have forgotten how to discern the voice in the voice, the Lord in the body that was being used. Sometimes God can use a donkey or the mouth of a donkey. God could use a cloud. God could use a false prophet. But that does not stop the Lord from saying the things he wants to say. I'm convinced that this move of God can change the earth. But I think at the same time, many of us have suffocated the grace of God because of a root of bitterness that may not have been caused by your desire to be bitter, but by your anger at the way in which certain things were presented to you. And I'd like to be the first today to ask you to forgive me if I have in any way presented this message in a way that was insensitive to the fact that you held on to a position that I offended. And I realize now that it takes the lips of grace, the tongue of the learned, the skill of a wise man, to deconstruct inaccurate systems before we build the house of God with the wisdom and counsel that comes from the heavens. We may not have allowed ourselves to be that, but today, on behalf of all of those that may have misrepresented the message to you, and not just to you, but those that are listening to us through live streaming, and those that will get a copy of this, so those who will hear of the sound that has been released from this platform, I want to say sorry on behalf of all of us if we've not presented this message right. But I also want you to know that our conviction is that there's no better way and there's no way of compromise concerning this message. This is the way of the Lord. As sure as God is, this season can redeem us from captivity. And so I'm asking us today to also release, I'm asking you to release those that have offended you. Forgive them. It's the best thing for you to do. Bless them. One of the most powerful messages I heard, shared over 30 minutes, was given to us at my son's gathering by John Alley the other day before this conference. He spoke about the spirit of accusation, the spirit of jealousy. He said, the best way to deal with those that come against you is to first ask for confession. Forgive them, then ask for confession, and then release grace and thanksgiving to the Lord. You can get a copy of that. I'm sure my office can try and make it available to you, just that section. But I want to say today, let's release today. Let's forgive. Let's bless. Because let me tell you, we are only robbing ourselves of ourselves, being where God wants to be. So will you stand with me? Can we get a microphone to John? John, would you come and just release that spirit, that untainted spirit, that pure spirit? You're a man of the spirit. Just pray for us all. Pray for us. Come, before John prays, just bring your hearts to the Lord, as I would do mine. Bring your spirits before him. Shalamondala basikat.
In the spirit of prayer, just while you're listening for a moment, could I make this comment? A lot of people think that ministry is about public performance. That is, you know, you're achieving something. And whilst all of that is important, a lot of people have elevated the idea of them doing great things above what really is the central message of the New Testament, that we walk in love toward one another. I've come to believe very much that in this day, or in these coming days, if someone would claim to be an apostle, they had better learn the way of love as their primary message. But we've been so institutionalized and so therefore performance oriented. And for many people, it's too much about the size of the church and planting more churches. And whilst all those things are important, we forget that the great command of the Lord Jesus was, as I have loved you, so you also must love one another. And if that is his, if that is the new command of the new covenant, then to represent that is to truly represent Christ. So if someone comes claiming to be an apostle, but it's all about other things in the main, and they have no message on love, they're not truly representing Christ in the main. And so I just remind you, Paul said, you know, if I speak with the tongues of, if I have faith that, and so on and so forth, but have not love. We really must make that the center of ourselves and of the church again. Anyway, I didn't want to take time over it, but Again, it's why the real wineskin of the church is father-son relationship, but if you just understand it structurally, you miss the point. Just as, see, when I wrote the first book, I was worried that people would just think it was a new structure, and so once again they'd rush off with their own strength to build something and miss the heart of it, miss the spirit of it. Well, particularly when you teach apostles. In fact, we used to teach about apostles and apostolic authority, and then later we would teach about sonship. I reversed the order. I started teaching about the spirit of sonship and relationships before I taught anybody anything about apostles and apostolic authority, because they had to get the spirit of it right. Anyway, I just plead for that. So let me pray this prayer. And I remember a scripture that says, all your children will be taught of the Lord, and great will be your children's shalom. Shalom. There is an anointing for peace. I've thought that it is one of Christianity's two greatest anointings. It has many meanings. It does many things. I don't have time to define it, but I'm going to release that grace, the peace of the Lord Jesus. And this purity, yeah, a Christianity without guile. Let's believe God can change our hearts and that there is grace from heaven. Father, I thank you for the goodness of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I thank you for the Holy Spirit who brings to us the presence of the Father and the Son. And I thank you for the transforming power of grace. I thank you, Lord, that just a word from you, a touch from you, and we can be changed. We see this when men and women are born again or baptized in the Holy Spirit and many other breakthroughs. I thank you we're in this place today where grace is present. You are present. And I'm asking, Lord, that even now you'd put the finger of God upon the heart of every person in this room. But not only upon them, upon this nation, upon South Africa. Put the hand of God upon this land. And then, Lord, put the hand of God upon every nation in Africa, more than 60 of them. Lord, I'm believing you for a day of grace that transforms all these nations, including all of North Africa. I thank you. These are good days, and we will see better days, for the gospel shall do its great work. And so I thank you for the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I bring the peace of God upon Africa today. I place the peace, the shalom of the Lord Jesus, over the whole of Africa, and I release that anointing into this continent. And I place peace upon you, everyone standing here today, and upon your marriages and homes. I say peace to you. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, I bring from heaven above this anointing, the shalom of the Lord Jesus. I place it on your minds. I place it upon your hearts. In Jesus' name, I release it to you. I thank you, Lord, for this grace. And now, in that peace and under the hand of God, I ask that you'd make our hearts all the more clean. Forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and grant that the purity and the simplicity of devotion to Christ would be all the more established in us. And I ask you, Lord, that from this moment there'd be a grace in the heart of all by which they can see to love and understand to love. Lord, we lack the words, but I can see by the Holy Spirit that right now you are willing to release a grace in this place that causes everyone to see each other with new eyes and to have a different heart for one another. And I bring that grace down upon this place, the spirit of community, the spirit of transparency and humility, the spirit of holiness and the spirit of understanding. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, I place upon you these graces and I release them to you. The Lord give you eyes to see one another. And I ask you, Lord, that you'd remove out of the heart of every person here that spirit of striving, which causes us to be in competition with one another. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, take out of their hearts right now that spirit of competition and release into every heart the spirit of community. And so in the name of the Lord Jesus, I place this grace upon you, properly called the spirit of understanding, and I release it to you in Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord, that from this very hour, this people will have new eyes to see each other. And so I bless this people, I bless this house, and I bless all the days to come for the apostolic ministry in this nation and the nations represented here today. I thank you, Lord, for the good hand of God that is upon us. We give thanks to God. We thank you, Lord. Yes, amen. Yeah. I'm serious about that grace that so changes hearts, you see each other differently. And maybe tomorrow, if I get a chance, I'll explain that, because I think it's always better, there's a better manifestation of it when we understand it. So thank you. Yes.
Thank you, John. Well, that's it.